Strategic Minerals is an AIM-listed junior miner with assets in the US and in New Zealand. And it's also looking to explore other areas throughout the world as well. But unlike most junior miners, their focus isn't just on digging holes and filling it with development cash. They're actually having a business plan which is about generating income and, heaven forbid, even possibly paying a dividend. So a very different type of miner. Well, let's join the managing director of Strategic Minerals, John Peters, now, who comes to us live from the Southern Hemisphere. John, it is true, isn't it, that you have a very different approach. How can you generate income with these relatively small scale projects, which are perhaps risky?
Well, thank you, Nigel. Look, you've hit on one of our big differential points, and that is basically that we've been focused. We have an existing asset, Cobre, which is providing us cash flow, and we've been focused on projects that are near-term cash flow positive. So, in other words, things that will start generating cash within about 18 to 24 months. But we're not someone just going out trying to buy assets that might have a cash flow. We also have other requirements, such as the fact that we are looking mainly at projects that are based around local demand, and we're finding that that helps insulate ourselves against price movements as well in whatever the resource is. Also, we tend to look for things that might have potential upside later on, but of course, importantly, by picking things that have low cash flows, we tend to find that our IRR hurdles and our payback periods are very much in line with what we were after. And so it tends to de-risk a lot of what we're looking at. And so combining those factors together, we try to find projects that will fit into them. And we've been lucky so far. We found the Tatu project, which we're executing at the moment. We've been looking at a very large one in China. And that, again, becomes a question of, while all the ducks might be lined up, we've also got to make sure that if we're looking at something like that, can we fund it properly, et cetera, et cetera. So, and apart from that, there's another project we're considering also in the Northern Hemisphere. But at the moment, we continue to research on that basis to try and add value for our shareholders.
Yeah, but why is it that you can add value with these projects, whereas the previous owners and operators have rejected them? I mean, is it just because your ambitions are very small scale?
Yeah, I'd love to say that we're special, but we're not. What we're really saying is we're picking a niche. We're picking a niche where the size of the projects are not enough to make them worthwhile for the larger operators. In fact, if anything, it's probably the amount of management time they're putting in with is a bigger headache for them. And whereas for us, the smaller scale projects are just right for our team to manage through. And you know, we're looking at, for example, Tatu. Tatu is expected volumes of 200,000 tonnes per annum.
Tatu is one in New Zealand we're talking about, which is thermal coal.
Not in New Zealand, yes. Yeah. Sorry, Tatu is the New Zealand project. If we pick up, if you were to clear $10 after tax on that, that's $2 million a year. If we... The policy we've been trying to adopt is to layer a couple of these projects on, because that $2 million runs on for 20 years. So if we start to layer one on top of another on top of another, we start to build the company into a formidable company with good earnings. And, of course, a lot of that earnings is designed to then get ourselves in a position where we start to pay dividends, as you mentioned at the beginning of this.
Mm. So looking at the Tatu one, which is, when's that going to start generating decent production, and when is it going to start generating enough income for you to pay a dividend?
Well, the as we've said before, we just we announced recently, we just got approval from the government to transfer the license of Tatu. And we're in the process now finishing off the financing package to take it through. And we're about to undergo some work on doing a bulk sample for the for the markets to start to try to bring in our sales into a more solid position. But we'd expect production, we expect construction of the mine to occur towards the end of this year. Now, while the mine is actually being constructed, we're actually pulling out some coal, which we can start to sell. So we will actually start to have sales, but obviously moderate sales, or smaller size scale sales, in the first half of next year. And it's the latter half of next year we expect to be capable of a full production.
But of course, the good thing about that then
means we're probably into the next year for a potential dividend.
Yeah, but of course, the great thing about the small scale of this is and also the fact that it's focused on the domestic market is, there's a lot. It's a lot less complicated. You're not having to sort of be a slave to import and export prices.
Well, you're right. One of the reasons why we adopted this this policy of looking for local market servicing is that it de-risks projects a lot. This one in New Zealand, there is quite a significant amount of coal being imported from Indonesia, which we believe we can be competitive against. And also on the China one that we're looking at, within a scope of about 150 kilometres, there are three major steel producing mills that use approximately 50 million tonnes of coal per annum. So these substitution positions make it very strong for us and also underwrite or reduce our risk profiles in doing all of this.
Yeah. So I suppose you're in a very good position because you've got these three areas at the moment, or two, and then the possibility of China, and Cobre, which is in New Mexico, which is the iron ore. I mean, that's basically just quite happily washing its face, making some money. That's providing the...
It's ticking along and providing its cash flow, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's being run properly, and we try to do as much as we can to increase the sales, but at the moment the market isn't overly, there doesn't appear to be too many additional people looking for the product. So, at the moment, the cash flows are very, very good and they help us along.
Yeah, and of course, there's always a potential that if the market picks up, then because you're way under capacity there, you could actually ramp it up and take advantage of changes in the market.
Well, the previous time we shipped through rail and everything about 600,000 tonnes. So if it ever happened, if the prices recovered, we could always go back to that. But at the moment, prices have dropped a long way on the iron ore. So, we're not relying on that, which is why we sought other projects that would give us, again, near-term cash flow, that we could lever off the cash flow from Cobre to help us with.
Yeah. I wanted just to sort of talk about one issue, which I know has been some shareholders, investors are focusing on, and that's the fact you just bought some more shares. Now, interestingly, you bought the shares at the issue price, but above the prevailing price. Is that really just a vote of confidence in your product, in your business plan?
It's two things. I mean, in the last couple of months, I've bought now close to about almost just under 8 million shares in the company. I bought 4.7 of them at market, around 0.5 of a P. But I also went back, when we originally did our issue, I indicated to people that I wanted to participate. But unfortunately, I was in a lockout position relating to the issuance of our annual accounts and also the putting on of our new chairman. So I wasn't in a position to participate. And I've always felt that the 0.6 issuing price is very good value. And so after it had occurred and after I was in a position where I could actually buy again, I actually went ahead and still bought 3 million shares at the issue price of 0.6, which at the time was close to probably 50% above the market price. But I purchased it basically because, one, I believe you're going to be managing something, you've got to be invested as well. You've got to have some skin in the game. because that means you're then acting like you're acting on the best interests of all shareholders, because you're one of them.
Yeah.
But also, I thought it was an honourable thing to do, to actually show that I did feel that the 0.6 was a reasonable price. And the number of shares I bought, it was 3 million shares, so it was not an inconsiderable amount of my own personal money. And, you know, yes, it's a vote of confidence in the stock, but really it's just my own personal belief.
All right. Well, John Peters, thank you very much indeed for joining us. And we will look with interest to see how these various projects develop.
Thank you, Nigel.